Welcome to this episode of Eureka, and this is a Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award special. In this episode, we are going to have a very interesting, illuminating conversation with a mathematician, Dr. Rajat Subra Asa. He is from Indian Statistical Institute, Calcutta. And in today's discussion, we are going to discuss with him about sand pile, odometer, and whatnot. You may think that what is that to discuss about sand pile, but quite a lot of interesting maths is behind sand pile. That's one area that we are going to discuss. This is one of the areas that got him his Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award. Thank you for being with us in this show. First of all, please accept our congratulations for this award that you have got.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for inviting me also.
Yeah. So let me start with your citation, which reads as following, that you have made outstanding contribution to multiple frontier areas of probability theory. It says multiple areas. So some of them they have listed are like random matrices and the use of that random matrices for free probability and also which contributed to areas like random field, random graph. So this seems to be one area. And also your work is touching upon themes which are related to physics, such as sand pile model, membranes, and I suppose something called odometer. Of course, we know about odometer in our vehicles, cars, and other vehicles. I suppose we will discuss each of them one by one. So let's start with a very simple understanding. Okay, probability. Okay.
Yeah.
Many of us think that probability is basically ignorance, meaning that if I toss a coin, I take a guess, I may be right or wrong, but basically it's because if I do actually a real good physics, I mean, like how did I toss the coin? What was its first position? What is the wind velocity? And so on, so on. You would be able to actually predict how many tumble that the coin will take and then finally land. So basically it's ignorance or maybe complexity of doing computation. That's what is probability. That's what most of us presume. So as a person who is working on this area, how do you react to this?
That's a very interesting comment. Like, I would say it's since you spoke about ignorance, let me like make it more precisely more ignorant. We are making a quantification of our ignorance. That how much ignorant are we? Now, if you look at the complement or the opposite of ignorance, that is how much we know, actually. So that is probability in that sense is it's whether you are quantifying certain events which are certain to happen or uncertain to happen. So so that's a quantification of the ignorance. Let me put it that way, like in that sense. So sometimes we need to know how much ignorant we are. And probability theory definitely helps in that thing.
Okay. Very, very interesting. I mean, so see, most of us get some bit of introduction to probability theory in our school.
Right.
And the way that usually it's introduced is dice. I mean, dice with six faces. I mean, so numbered 1 to 6. So if you roll a dice, that you will get any of the number between 1 to 6. And then if you roll enough number of times, the chance of getting any of this number is kind of equal.
Equal. Right.
Right. So this is what we get. From this, mostly we assume that suppose if I roll and then get 3 times, let's say 4, we think that the possibility that it'll again be 4 is rather very limited.
Right. That's definitely, you can, so for example, that's the beauty of probability, that it gives you the quantification that how can you predict or how much chance there is for 2 consecutive appearance of 4 when you roll a die, like, so these kind of probabilities or chances, it doesn't mean that when you are rolling, like on the 5th roll, you will definitely get a 4 and on the 6th roll, you will definitely get a roll. But there is a chance, there is a value between 0 and 1, which we assign and say that this is the chance of getting it. If the value is very close to 1, then we say that the chance is very high. And if the value is close to zero, then we say the chance is very low.
Very, very interesting. I mean, this leads me to a question in which you were kind of a public celebrity for some time.
that's
a question paper that you had set up for your university.
Yeah, it's quite a bit of
that, if you don't mind.
Okay, so it's a nice story. Sometimes I even tell it in my talks about network theory also, because it was a real life experience of small world network in a sense for me. So we say the world is very small. So that's a network theory nomenclature we use, and it was an experience. So I was teaching martingale theory in the master's course here for statistics, and I just stumbled upon. So there is a famous question in a book by Williams, which says that if a person types randomly, like what is the probability that the word, what is the expected time that the word abracadabra would come?
Okay.
Now, abracadabra is a very special word. If you see, if you write A-B-R-A-C-A-D-A-B-R-A. So first, the first four letters and the last four letters appear in that way.
Yeah.
So the calculation is quite complicated. So I did this computation in the class, and I thought, let me check with another word if the people understood it in the class. Then this Covfefe word was quite famous during that time. So it was appearing in newspaper, in Twitter, and everywhere.
Basically,
so
because it was tweeted by Donald Trump that time.
Right, and, right. He just misspelled the word coverage and typed in Covfefe. So I just put it, and next day what happened was, I think the students, some of the students put it in the Facebook or Twitter, and it got viral. So I started receiving calls from everywhere that it's kind of gone very viral. Some people are even hashtagging President of the United States and everything. Then the newspaper started coming in, like, and I'm very happy that the question, although the answer was quite simple, actually, like it was not much, like 26 power 7 or something. What happened was it generated a quite of interest in probability, that these kind of questions, people started writing programs, started writing algorithms, they started giving solutions through Markov chains. So although it's a very well-known problem in probability, but it generated the interest in common people, like it was a question, somehow it clicked with everyone. Everyone understood the question. And nowadays, like I saw in one of the textbooks, that they have gave it as a problem in the textbook also. In ISI, like what happens is we have a very interesting feature of teaching. Like we sometimes do give problems which are real life. Like you give questions on votings or other things, like even like different kind of cricket matches, so that people get more interested in this subject. So this was one such experience. It was, I thought it might get out of hand, but thankfully it didn't get out of hand.
It was hilarious at the same time, I suppose, as you said, a good pedagogic technique. So let me lead from this. For example, this kind of a question, what will be the, let's say, the time that may be required on the average for such a misspelling to take place.
Right.
How would it connect to, let's say, some kind of utility or how does it apply in real life in various situations? Is there any connection between such kind of esoteric mathematics and real world that we live in?
No, definitely. So, because you see, what happens is probability is in many sense. So these are some kind of a problem which is, we need it every day in, say, for example, in network science, you are looking at some kind of an event which is happening or not. Like, so you want to predict whether the event will almost surely happen or not, like with very high chances will happen or not. Then these kind of analysis do help. Sometimes it says that there is a very high chance that something might go wrong or something might go viral. Say, for example, it's a, if you take the network of Twitter, so sometimes if you put in a, some kind of a dynamics, then you can predict that this kind of thing might get more viral. For example, this can be again translated to biological networks. So there is a spread of epidemics. So you can always ask questions like if there is an epidemic and it spreads like an infection in the form of, say, even in, like the form in COVID, like you would like to predict whether it will stop at some point or not with high probability,
okay,
with probability close to one. So these kind of things do interest probabilists in a sense. So that's I think that's the utility in that sense. Like
let me now come to a very specific area that you are working. One area the citation is pointing out is an area called sandpile. We have all as children played with sand. We have all made sandpile. So we have mostly real life experience with sandpile. Where is mathematics coming into it?
Sandpile is a very interesting topic in that sense. Like it was mainly started by three physicists, Back, Tang and Wiesenfeld. So they used it to model something called self-organized criticality.
Okay.
So this is a phenomena in nature. Like, for example, like say something in our brain triggers a impulse. So it spreads everywhere. But at certain points, say, for example, anger, say it spreads everywhere. It spreads a kind of impulse in your brain for some time and then it stabilizes at some point.
Yeah.
So it's a criticality which is assuming, like which is happening in the brain. So when something is being triggered, something you are seeing. So this is a feature which is appearing in nature everywhere. Say, for example, like if there is a dam which is overflowing, at some point, what happens, maybe the dam breaks or there is an overflow, there is a flood. But this flood will at some point get subdued and everything will spread enough and this will come down. So now this kind of phenomena, you can see, you can now compare it with a sand pile. Say you have a huge sand pile and then you pour in few of, it's already in a critical state. Say it's in a, like a dune in the desert. Then you put in some more sands on it. Then what happens, you will see that the sand will fall down like an avalanche. So yeah, there will be an avalanche and it will again settle at a certain height.
Okay.
So this kind of, so what you do is there is a, so there is a mathematics in it. So a toy example would be, so you take a, say, mesh of mesh on it and you start putting in grains at every point.
Okay.
And you put a threshold above which the grains will topple and give its neighbors more sand than the excess sand to it. So it kind of produces a ripple in that. Now this is a, so what happens, it forms a very nice structure after it settles down. So now there has been, so for example, in India, there Indian physicist, Professor Deepak Dhar, from who was in TIFR.
Okay.
So he was one of the first ones to do the mathematics of it.
Okay.
And it's a very interesting mathematics and there are very difficult problems in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I dealt with something a bit different from these sand pile models. So it was that you start with a, initially you don't start with a fixed number of height of the sand piles. What you do is you put a white noise in it. Okay. So there are lots of random things which are there. Then you start toppling. And now the question comes, like, how is the odometer coming in?
Mm-hmm.
So what we do is we look at a one site in the in your mesh and we look at the mass when after, before it stabilizes, how much mass it has emitted. Now we calculate this. If the mass is finite, we call it an odometer of that point.
Okay.
Because odometer is, we know in the car, it measures the number of kilometers we have traveled.
Yeah, yeah.
So here it is the number of grains a particle has emitted that we study.
Okay.
And that has a very interesting feature. Look, so just let me take 2 minutes and explain you that, that is related to something in very important in mathematics, which is called the biharmonic operator. And this operator came into feature not now, but in very old times when there was a musician and philosopher, Chladni.
Uh-huh.
So Chladni did some experiments with his bow and arrow. So bow and arrow. So let me perhaps I can here share the screen.
Yeah.
And show you the experiment Gladney did.
Yeah, yeah, sure, sure. I think if you want, you can also share, and then let's share, and then why don't you explain that phenomenon?
Yeah. So let me show you an experiment which Gladney, who was a magician and a philosopher, and also a mathematician, physicist, and during that time. So what he did was he took a metal plate, fixed it at the center, and put some sand grains on it. He hit the sides with a bow of a metal. Let me show you what happens. This is a more modern experiment of that. So this is what is the bow of the metal was doing. It was making different sounds. Okay. And the sand used to settle like this. You can see it is forming a nice pattern. So this is the sand particles which are being put. Uh-huh. And there is a music. Now the people put it through wires and everything. But previously they used to do it with the bow. So you can hit it on the bow and you see different patterns are coming. So these patterns are quite interesting. So they were called Gladney plates. He used to draw them in hand.
Okay.
And he went to Napoleon to asking that whether people can explain this.
Uh-huh.
So Napoleon was very fascinated and he launched a competition.
Uh-huh.
And only one person actually got through it in the third attempt. She was not a proper mathematician, but she made immense contribution, Sophie German.
Yeah.
Okay. And she gave an explanation through something called a biharmonic operator. And she wrote down some equations. And from there, she got the thing. Now, this became later in 1900, it became a major area of study also.
Mm-hmm.
Now, one of the interesting features in our research was to get a connection between this biharmonic operator and the sand pile I was talking about, the odometer.
Okay.
So in mesoscopic scale, we could the odometer is exactly related with the picture you see here in a very broad sense. The clear connection is still more mathematics is needed. And I hope in future we'll get more clear connections to this problem. But it's a very interesting problem. Many people didn't do it for 100 years, but I think there is a very nice connection to it.
Oh, that was really very amazing. The kind of pattern that were coming when you change the frequency, shapes. One would not even guess that when you change slightly the frequency, the shape will change so much. Right. I mean, it's really very amazing. So your citation is also talking about another area called membrane. That's also another area that you are studying. So what is this membrane? What is their mathematics?
So membrane is a sort of interface. Let me tell you a specific interface, which I give an example. So people have gone to Gangotri. So they have seen Alakananda and Bhagirathi. So they mix at some point, like when... Now, if you go there, you will see that if you stand on the top, the two waters have different colors.
Yeah.
And when they mix, there is a clear demarcation that the two rivers are mixing.
Yeah.
Now that is a random interface for us. Okay. Because what is happening is the river is coming in different speed and you see a zigzag line which is kind of forming.
Yeah.
That is called a one-dimensional interface.
Okay.
And that is an example of a membrane also, actually. Mm-hmm. So what happens, membrane is, what we say membrane is sort of when two phases of substance which mixes and they form an interface. Now, this interface can be formed in higher dimension also.
Okay.
So this is a one dimension which we can see eyes, but there are higher dimension things. So one of my studies in membrane is to understand how this behavior is actually. So what kind of trajectory that zigzag line follows, whether there is a precise path which we can describe to make that precise. So that's the mathematics behind that, which we do.
That's okay. That's also very interesting, like how, for example, a real life phenomena also, we see that kind of a membrane. Perhaps it's also happening in other places where multiple factors are interacting to each other. So now let me come to questions slightly differently. Like, for example, many of the computers that we use, the operating system, sometimes when you are giving it some command, it takes a lot of time. Perhaps we find that it's not okay, so we shut down it and then restart it, etc. But suppose if you are sending a spacecraft, that is not, I mean, people cannot wait, or rather the computer cannot wait for quite a long time. I mean, you need to know how within a particular time that has to come with a solution or not, right?
Right.
So, are your kind of questions, the kind of question that you are attempting, whether it is sand pile or membrane or other area, how are they connected with such kind of challenges that we have today with the new technology or new areas of research, even questions related to physics and so on?
Yeah, no, there are many challenges in our research. One of the challenges is what we are doing. So as I said, let us take a mesh and then do the computation or whatever it is. Nowadays, if you see, we don't have meshes. Actually, meshes are very mathematical objects.
Yeah.
What we face is nowadays when we do the mathematics behind is a network or a graph. So whatever dynamics we are doing in many things, say it's an epidemiology or a computer science problem or a social network, what we are like to apply these results is on random graphs. Uh-huh. So what we want to do is study all these things. When we are doing that, we are doing it on a fixed mesh or something like that, but it's no longer a mesh. So we have certain points and we have certain connections in between. And we want to do it on such graphs. And that is the biggest challenge. And I think in future, the way we are going completely, socially, economically, every way we are now becoming, becoming a network. It's a one huge network which we are beginning. True. So everything which we want to apply, I think we should apply it on the networks which we are getting, in real life networks which we are getting. So I think that's the biggest hurdle, and I think we should at least my plan to plan my research in the future coming years in this direction so that the science is properly developed in this area.
Thank you for being in the show. For want of time, we may have to end our conversation here. It was a very interesting, very illuminating conversation.
Thank you for inviting me.
Keep watching, Eureka. We'll come back with another episode same time next week.